Early before in case I forget at the end. Right, well, my talk today is about angels, but angels with dirty faces. So at Chowani International College, I'm going to be talking a little bit about the school, which, you know, you might want to hear about as well, I'll be rehashing some ideas that I already talked about in an article on the New Liturgical Movement website, with a few other thoughts and quotations in it, and also some reflections about how participation in prayer and the liturgy changes boys. So a lot of this will be familiar to people, some things will be new. So at our English Catholic boarding school for boys, Chavannes International College, situated in the west of France near Nantes, Holy Mass is celebrated daily in the main college chapel, according to the 1962 Missal, now, for all boys and masters. On Sundays, Mass and Vespers in the extraordinary form attract parents of pupils and a growing local following of friends and supporters. In addition, there are confessions, adoration, benediction, and other devotions held regularly in our chapel. The strains of Gregorian chant can be heard every day. Why, you might ask, do we place the church's liturgy at the heart of our life as a school? Perhaps I might answer this by an attempt at telling the story of Catholic education from an English standpoint and with a rather long view. At Chavannes, we have taken as our blueprint the checklist for Catholic schools from Vatican II's Gravissimum Educationis, a broad education, not just confined to religious teaching, a deep education, which creates a habit of intellectual discipline, a moral formation, and lastly, a formation in prayer, especially in the context of the sacred liturgy. That document is nearly 60 years old now, but its philosophy is much older, as I'll try and demonstrate. When, about 20 years ago, I was setting up Chavannes International College, I studied the handbooks of several leading English public schools to give me some inspiration. My own. Browsing through the correct and crisp prose on the arcana of school uniform, regulation haircuts, and sports gear, I noticed a common feature of several leading boarding schools of the day, such as Stowe and Rugby. Boys were not only expected to attend chapel services daily, but were also obliged to be present in chapel on a Sunday, of course, and to keep the Sabbath day holy. In cases where parents took their sons home for the weekend, which was discouraged, they were asked to provide the name and telephone number of the incumbent of the parish their son would be attending on Sunday morning at home, to enable the school's authorities to check that he had been to church. I've even heard anecdotes of rich stepfathers waiting outside English country churches in their comfortable convertibles, while their sleepy stepsons, who had been hauled out of bed after a night of partying, dozed through prayer book matins and a dreary sermon in a discreet pew near the back door. Nowadays, such happenings are rare. Priorities have sadly changed. And with COVID and its lockdown, many things will never be the same again. But within living memory, our nation's leading places of education recognize strongly the centrality of worship to education. Moreover, the only mandatory elements of state education, from the 1947 Education Act right through to the 1980s, were Christian religious instruction and a daily act of worship in state schools. No other country in Europe had a law like this. The roots of this tradition are very deep. In England today, we still have, and can count, hundreds of schools founded during the first millennium of pre-Reformation English Christianity. That is unique. And despite the trauma of the Reformation, many had, until perhaps the last decade or so, held on to the idea that the best education is one which has the worship of God at its heart. And as I approach 50 this year, I remember with fondness the county primary school where we read the Bible, prayed several times a day, and sang traditional hymns in the 1970s. It all seemed completely normal then. Yeah. Later on, at senior school, there were perhaps fewer prayers, but there was much study of scripture, and as a chorister, I got to sing plenty of Palestrina, Bach, and Mozart. I was a Catholic boy in an Anglican school, but I could tell it was a good one. And a positive experience of both primary and secondary school got me interested in education at an early age. Let's forget the tyranny of the progressive left at the moment. We live with it every day. And let's do something that the left never does, because it's always afraid and always self-centered. Let us lift our gaze and see something that has been forgotten in public discourse, particularly of an academic kind, and yet is staring us all in the face. In the world today, there are 8 billion people. Can you best guess how many of them do not believe in God? It would seem to be somewhere between 5 and 7%. If you don't believe me, just ask Google. Lift up your gaze and see that in this whirlwind of atheism, which we spend so much of our time swimming, it isn't the whole ocean. It's only a small part of it. Let the perspective of history throw us a lifeline, and we'll see a truth that perhaps we'd never noticed before, that there are many important matters on which mankind through time and space is in an almost unanimous agreement. But this is the most striking one. We believe in God. And because we do, everything else flows from that. Man's most profound identity is that of a creature brought into existence by a loving creator who has a plan for us and who gives our lives a purpose. This world in which God reigns supreme is the world into which we should be initiating the young, because it is the real world. Unless we want them to drown in the scary but insignificant whirlpool of atheism, the first thing they need to learn from us is how to pray. A little boy of my acquaintance, who is not raised in a church-going family, was sad when he heard his grandfather had developed cancer and might die. During a visit, he kissed his granddad and he said, "Granddad, I'm praying for you." "Where did you learn how to pray?" said Grandad. "At school," said the little boy, quite simply and without any hesitation. The legacy of the 1947 Education Act is still doing some good, I thought, when I heard this story. Every child should be taught to pray like this, especially because children's prayers are the best prayers. And goodness knows, we need them. Let me tell you about the very first ever Catholic boarding school for boys, which you've heard about before if you've been to another one of these talks, in the late second century in the shadow of the great library of Alexandria, where 3 centuries before, the librarian Eratosthenes had first calculated the circumference of the globe. In that school, which followed the trivium and the quadrivium, they also were taught catechetics and attended the liturgy every day. And here's a few verses of a hymn which was written by St. Clement of Alexandria, the headmaster of the school, in a metrical English translation, which makes it singable. "Shepherd of tender youth, guiding in love and truth through devious ways." You could sing it to the tune, "Thou whose almighty word." Da 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 da. "The shepherd of tender youth, guiding in love and truth through devious ways, Christ our triumphant King, we come thy name to sing, hither our children bring tributes of praise. So now until we die, sound we thy praises high and joyful sing. Let all the holy throng who to thy church belong unite and swell the song to Christ our King." Now, I'm reliably informed by somebody who's much more au fait with the niceties of Greek, that the exact imagery of the song makes it clear that it was a dance as well. Perhaps not during the liturgy, who knows, it ought to be too controversial, but very Greek. There were a lot of hymns in the East at that time. St. Ephrem of Syria wrote a lot as well. And they're all a bit like that. So that, if you like, that's the first hymn of a Catholic school. We need to move on 300 years to the rule of Saint Benedict in the 5th century to understand how this great tradition came to spread throughout Europe. This is a tradition of education, the trivium and the quadrivium, and daily prayer and worship at its heart. In his rule, Benedict calls the monks to practice each day a special kind of prayer called meditation, in which the Christian repeats in a low voice the words of a sacred text. That's the way they considered meditation at the time. A little bit like the Jesus prayer, I suppose. And they would repeat this text themselves, savor it, and draw out its meaning. But you can't do that if you can't read. So in order to practice meditation in this sense of the word, you need to be able to read. And also, in order to get through the Psalter of 150 Psalms, you need to be able to read. There are all sorts of reasons why you need to be able to read. So Benedict orders that during meditation time, which is part of the rule, the boys, together with any men under 50 who can't yet read, shouldn't meditate, but should instead learn to read. And he says, as long as you're under 50, it's worth learning to read. Well, I'm 50 this year, and I can already read, so I just made it in. And then he says, we've talked about meditation, we've talked about the Psalter. But these monasteries then, even before St. Benedict, were not only places of prayer, they were also repositories of secular knowledge, of culture. Going back to the Greeks, and schools, qua schools, such as there were always very much communities of prayer. These were the places that kept the light of civilization burning while everything else seemed to be collapsing in Europe. And it was this new rule of St. Benedict which gave a new impetus to monasticism and to education. It was this rule of St. Benedict that spread education and the worship of God in choir and in the liturgy through Europe, thus coming to the rescue of cultural continuity and to the spreading of the gospel. But this important role which the rule of St. Benedict played in the promotion of Christian education is really all down to one man, St. Gregory the Great. St. Gregory the Great was a rich young man who'd set up a community following St. Benedict's rule in his family villa. And when he became Pope, he famously sent Augustine all the way to Canterbury with a group of Anglo-Saxon boys discovered in a slave market in Rome. He'd seen these fair-haired youths and wondered at their strange appearance. When he acquired as their identity, he was told, Anglisunt, they are Angles. He said, non Angli, said Angeli, not Angles, but Angels, if only they were Christians. And so these boys then were brought out of slavery and given the monastic tonsure, perhaps not too long after being baptized. And so English Catholicism was born. They accompanied Augustine across the Channel as his translators, and out of this community grew the very first English Catholic boarding school with the worship of God at its heart, and it still exists today, although it's not Catholic anymore. There were schools in Canterbury, Rochester. Other monastic schools sprang up all over England under the influence of Gregory the Great's Regula Pastoralis. He enjoined the setting up of schools. And that rule was that document was famously translated into Anglo-Saxon by Alfred the Great. Several of them still exist today. And it ought to be mentioned that in the Celtic fringes of the North and West and in Ireland, the Catholic faith had already been present since Roman times. In Ireland, monastic schools and even whole monastic villages had existed since the 5th century. This is where the Angles hadn't reached. We call it the Celtic fringe. We know all about the adventures of St. Augustine of Canterbury from the writings of St. Bede, who himself benefited from a 7th century monastic education in the monastery of Jarrow near Durham. Why am I going on about monastic education? Because it's this principle of an education being part of a community of prayer. Bede wrote mighty pedagogical treatises too, proof that only a generation or two after the mission to the Anglo-Saxons, the monastic school system was well and truly up and running all over England. And Gregory's angels had wings. How do we most resemble God? we most resemble God in our intellect. And in our intellect, we resemble the angels too. But for our intellect to meet God, we need the wings of prayer to lift us up to him. Education and worship then belong together. This is what the monastic education sought to do. In the time of the 9th century Viking incursions, Alfred the Great, who translated Pope Gregory's encyclical into Anglo-Saxon, renewed this call for universal education during a period of peace with the Northmen, and called for education for all, boys and girls, in fact. The main thing was to learn to read so that the knowledge of books and the words of prayer could enter the soul through the window of the eye. And not just Latin, but even Old English. When the Normans conquered England 2 centuries later in 1066, they subdued a pragmatic, more egalitarian and more learned race than themselves, which had already had a flourishing written literature in their native tongue, while written French was only in its infancy. Alfred's schools were really the first grammar schools in England, but learning to pray was very much part of what they sought to do, even if they were not annexes to monasteries, they had been set up as schools. They based their practices on the monasteries out of which their tradition of learning had grown. And so in what we come to call the Dark Ages, when the Roman Empire is in collapse and the threat of the Norsemen ever present, the English, along with the Welsh, the Irish, and the Scots, busied themselves with the creation of centers of prayer, culture, and learning. In a climate of uncertainty, but in a spirit of faith, the whole of England had, as it were, taken the Benedict option. Teaching of Greek declined, but Latin flourished, and the Greek stories were told again in Latin. Mathematical writings of Euclid, translated into Latin, were widely studied. There was no imperial system to keep all this going, but the church made a surprisingly good job of it, especially in England, Wales, Scotland and Ireland, despite their enormous distance from Rome. Continental Europe, meanwhile, was in turmoil, but in faraway Britain, where even girls went to school, in Ireland too, penitential monks recited all 150 psalms, not weekly, but daily. They were praying like mad for the rest of us. While Alfred the Great started his chain of Saxon schools, Charlemagne did the same in France, but he needed an Irishman, St. Clement of Ireland, to run his cathedral school for boys in Paris, where the boys, of course, obviously sang and observed at Mass, while an Englishman, Alcuin of York, ran the palace school in Aachen. And so, at the end of the 13th century, when Innocent III asked every religious house in Christendom to open a school, England already had quite a head start. By the time of the Reformation, there were Catholic schools in every English town. Monastic schools, chantry schools, colleges, grammar schools, all founded with the gifts of the faithful and built on daily prayer and worship. And in the late Middle Ages, when monastic vocations were in decline in England, the new foundations, such as Eton, for example, were still based on the monastic ideal. They looked like monasteries, with the liturgy at their heart. And the foundations that were made were odd to our eyes, in the sense that they would say money is left for the maintenance of a certain number of clerics to sing the office, to have Mass celebrated. But there wasn't that much provision made for teachers. Maybe they would have one or two teachers and about 10 clerics, but the understanding would be that the clerics would also teach. But the central part of the activity of the school, founded as a school, was the divine office and the liturgy and the Mass. This is, for example, in Eton. And Eton's ongoing kind of financial security was also associated with the fact that it was given a whole load of indulgences as a site of Marian pilgrimage. So it was a kind, it was not only was it a religious center, a religious community, but it became a religious hub. We look back with awe at the achievement of medieval education. And the most striking thing about it, at least in terms of our reflection today on the place of prayer and worship in schools, is that prayer and worship came first, just spelled out. Schools were first and foremost schools of the Lord's service, which is an expression of St. Benedict. The praise of God was brought together, which had brought together these religious medieval communities, and the classical education practiced in them was intimately linked to divine worship. It had a vertical dimension. Pius XI in 1929 writes of this achievement thus. Right back in the far middle ages, when there were so many, some have even said too many, note of irony there, monasteries, convents, churches, collegiate churches, cathedral chapters. There was attached to each one of these a home of study, of teaching, of Christian education. This is the Pope speaking, Pius XI, 1929. To these we must add all the universities spread over every country, and always by the initiative and under the protection of the Holy See and the Church. That grand spectacle, which today we see better, is as it is nearer to us and more imposing because of the conditions of the age. And it was the spectacle of all times. And they who study and compare historical events remain astounded at what the Church has been able to do in this matter, and marvel at the manner in which she had succeeded in fulfilling her God-given mission to educate generations of men to a Christian life, producing everywhere a magnificent harvest of fruitful results. But if we wonder that the Church in all times has been able to gather about her and educate hundreds, thousands, millions of students, no less wonderful is it to bear in mind that she has done so, what she has done, not only in the field of education, but in that also of true and genuine erudition, scholarship. For if so many treasures of culture, civilization, and literature have escaped destruction, this is due to the action by which the Church, even in times long past and uncivilized, has shed so bright a light in the domain of letters, of philosophy, of art, and in a special manner of architecture. End of quotation. The English medieval tradition featured song schools and grammar schools. That's the main divide. And I went to a hybrid of the two kinds. The school I attended in Southampton produced the celebrated hymn writer Isaac Watts. It was founded in 1554 to replace a chantry school, which had existed for centuries but was abolished at the time of the Reformation, like all the chantries, in 1548. So Southampton was 6 years without an official school as a result of that abolition. It seems likely that the late medieval chantry of St. Mary was itself a consolidation of earlier educational endeavours going back to the 8th or 9th century, when Southampton was already becoming an important town in the Kingdom of Wessex with Alfred the Great. I felt very privileged to share in these traditions when I was a boy. I even thought about my masters in their black gowns and the long chain of masters and monks before them, peacefully and prayerfully handing on what Matthew Arnold in Culture and Anarchy has called the best that has been thought and said. Of course, England famously looks very medieval wherever you go, even when most of it is from the 19th century. The Houses of Parliament and St. Pancras Hotel look like strange and ancient shrines, but they are pure 19th century. The romantic appeal to the ages of faith came from the Englishman's heart. Englishmen were looking collectively back to a lost golden age, partly because scientific progress was so fast as to feel destabilizing, and because the vast expansion of the empire was bewildering too. People needed a sure and certain anchor to hold on to, and they sought it out in education in a big way. Provincial grammar schools close to their communities were in fair shape, but the prestigious boarding schools now frequented by the aristocracy, such as Eton and Rugby, were now in a bad shape and in need of reform. They needed a revival. And when they got one, it was as much religious as pedagogical. It was, even within the worldview of an essentially Protestant religious settlement, a call back to our ancient, medieval, and monastic roots. England, in the midst of the age of steam and automation, set about filling the landscape with towering but somehow reassuring Gothic steeples. And many of them were those of a new cohort of collegiate establishments conceived in imitation of the medieval tradition. These brand new schools all featured the daily solemn worship of God at their very heart. The revival of this ideal in the 19th century, including Nathaniel Woodward's founding of the amazing Lancing College, there's a whole string of schools associated with Lancing, with its enormous chapel, which is the biggest in the world for a school. And of course, the reforms of the enlightened and kindly Dr. Thomas Arnold, headmaster of Rugby, were all part of a general religious awakening brought about due to and at the same time as and following on from the Oxford movement and other associated reactions to liberalism in the established church. The great Catholic schools founded roughly this time or a little bit later were part of that same spiritual revival, but they, of course, enjoyed the singular privilege of being the closest to its true Eucharistic heart, the Mass, the source and summit of all Christian endeavors. The Benedictine schools, such as Downside and Ampleforth, tended to attempt to short circuit back to the English Middle Ages and ended up creating Catholic versions of Eton and Winchester. This was successful for over a century. Meanwhile, the Jesuits at Stonyhurst followed their own continental tradition going back to the Ratio Studiorum of 1599, and they bolted onto this some English sporting traditions, which gained them quite a good reputation for rugby. Newman wrote of the Anglican public school tradition quite admiringly in his Idea of a University, critical of its defects, but essentially convinced that the English establishment, educational establishment of the first 1,000 years, had a very solid base. His efforts to create a school and a university in Reading and in Dublin, that would be an Eton and an Oxford as if the Reformation had never happened, produced a mixed bag of results. He was an ideas man, not really an administrator. His idea of a university is inspiring, but quite impractical and not without internal contradictions. Until very recently, his school in Reading maintained its identity quite strongly. It has now gone co-educational and the numbers of non-Catholic pupils are rising quickly. So it requires real tenacity to keep sight of one's heritage in these shifting sands. The decline of the religious communities associated with many of the great schools founded on this medieval model has meant that the role played by monastic education in our educational history risks fading from the popular imagination of Catholics and of all Christians. Monasteries were always thought of as powerhouses of prayer, but they were also powerhouses of prayerful education. The title of this talk, Angels Without Wings, is taken from an exchange between two Anglican clerics. And I'll read to you now from David Newsom's book, he's a great scholar of the 19th century, Godliness and Good Learning. Very interesting book. It's not really about the whole scene of 19th century education, or even the most famous people in it, like Dr. Thomas Arnold, but there are four or five characters, those kind of sort of biographical studies of them. But in the introduction, there's this exchange. What is a college without a chapel? Bishop Christopher Wordsworth once asked a friend, a canon of Winchester Cathedral. An angel without wings, was the prompt reply. The bishop went on his way rejoicing. We need not wonder at his pleasure. His friend had expressed in a single phrase the ideal of godliness and good learning, and had confirmed the bishop's own conviction that to separate education from religion was as grievous as to set a man to climb a mountain and then deprive him of a guide. He goes on to say, this is David Newsom, according to Arnold, education and religion were really two aspects of the same thing. I'm just going to say that again because it's quite an important quotation. According to Arnold, education and religion were really two aspects of the same thing. A system of instruction towards moral perfection It was therefore the function of the state to enable and encourage its members to aspire to the highest standards of Christian living. Just moving on, there's another little quotation here where he quotes from the collect of thanksgiving for the founder of Winchester College, so a 14th century founder of a school, late 14th century. William of Wykeham runs as follows. We give thee humble and hearty thanks, O merciful Father, for our founder, William of Wykeham, and all other our benefactors, by whose benefits we are in this college, brought up to godliness and good learning. And we beseech thee to give us grace, so to use thy blessings to the glory of thy name, that we may become profitable members in the church and commonwealth, and may be at last partakers of the immortal glory of the resurrection. Now, when I was at school, we had a very, very similar prayer, which said, Almighty, most merciful God, we, thine humble and unworthy servants, do give thee most something thanks for our founders, King Edward VI and William Capon, etc., etc. It was a very, very similar prayer. And it also had the same expression in it, by whose benefaction we're here brought up to godliness and good learning. So that expression, the good learning and the godliness, go hand in hand. So this comment then about the angels without wings reveals the extent to which our English concept of schools owes everything to the medieval monks. Before and behind every school epic lies its cosmology. And the school lives and breathes and makes present in a tangible way and a formative way the cosmology that animates it. Without its rites, without its ceremonies, without its sense of something beyond itself, as something which it serves, a school does not simply become boring or unattractive, it becomes unviable. If it does survive, then it becomes something else. It may become a chimera, neither one thing nor another, or it may actually become the expression of another ideology and another cosmology. Because the truth about people believing in anything when they stop believing in something is also true, unfortunately, of schools. Education was and will always be about piety. Look at the religious enthusiasm of someone like Greta Thunberg, or of a BLM protester, or the climate action people, or Extinction Rebellion, or, I mean, no, I'm not taking issue with any of the particular causes. I'm just drawing attention to the religious devotion of these people who have been educated in a system which has its priorities. And you're witnessing the power of education at transmitting a strong sense of cosmology, of duty, of call to action. Look at the way in which governments for a long time eschewed control for the soul of education. But now, all of a sudden, they're hungry for the control of education. We need to be suspicious of that. Hogwarts without magic falls. Tom Brown's rugby without Christ falls. Alfred the Great's Widgester without the Mass. The College of Our Lady at Eton without devotion to the Virgin. All of these are empty shells. And we can see them crumbling. It's sad to see, because we have an affection for their outward forms. It's a very English thing, even if their inner meaning has almost completely evaporated. None of this was really foreseeable 20 years ago. I remember when I visited Downside, for example, in the late 90s, co-education was out of the question. Catholic orthodoxy was back in vogue, and the educational tradition I have been discussing was back on the table after a generation of hippiedom. The newly appointed headmaster said to me that girls would be admitted over his dead body and that his school stood not just for Catholic values, but Catholic faith. And the liturgical and sacramental heart of a Christian education was again being recognized by many in the private sector as essential. I knew several head teachers of large secondary schools who were reintroducing whole school Lenten retreats and compulsory confession for every pupil. That might sound like a canonical heresy, but in fact, they had to go in and see the priest They didn't have to confess their sins necessarily. They could ask him how he was feeling or something. But of course, as they were told how to confess their sins and then said, now it's your turn to talk to the priest, of course, they would all go to confession. So we're talking of a school here of 1,000 boys. That's how it was achieved. There were schools, even in the state sector, that were actually building chapels with the Blessed Sacrament, as well as schools that were clearing the rubbish and stacks of chairs that had accumulated in old chapels. This was in the 90s. Places that have become storerooms were now rediscovering their original vocation. Even in the Church of England, as I remember it back in the 1990s from school, the conservative evangelicals and the Anglo-Catholics felt they had a sporting chance of keeping the show on the road. It seemed like young teachers and priests in the leading private schools would perhaps manage to carry out a kind of counter-reformation against the progressives, and that perhaps the good they did would spread out to the state-subsidized Catholic schools as well, starting with those schools that enjoyed a bit of freedom from the stolid diocesan structures. For example, the newly created grant-maintained schools that were able to manage their own budgets and hire their own teachers and all that sort of thing. But it didn't happen that way. Somehow, the left managed to regroup, and in the state sector, they managed to turn tools invented by the right, like the national curriculum, into a sleek ideological machine at the service of the progressive left. The Catholic private sector, desperately humiliated by the sexual misbehavior of its priests and monks, gave up the fight. And sadly, one of the casualties of this was prayer. It had been increasingly sidelined and secularized. One of our A-level students who used to attend a Catholic school in Kent mentioned that they were fortunate enough to have a weekly mass in his school. He and one girl, in a school of 1,000, were the only attendees. "Did she ever talk to you?" I asked him. "No," he said. "She was very quiet." A previous chaplain of ours here in France was asked to be chaplain of another local Catholic boarding school here in the Vendée. His duties here included daily mass and confessions. In the other school, of 1,500 pupils, he was called on once a term to celebrate mass, at which three pupils were in attendance. In religious education and in liturgy, the paralysis of most parish priests, caused by the multiple knocks to clerical confidence, which have been administered by a series of child abuse scandals, have meant that time and time again, the well-educated have had to give way to the well-meaning. And we are left with masses that resemble a TV game show at which the priest is made to feel at best distinctly uncomfortable and at worst distinctly irrelevant. Our college was founded in 2002 in a former junior seminary on whose site once stood a medieval Benedictine monastery. We opened at a time when a few independent schools in the UK on both sides of the Reformation divide belonged still quite recognizably to this tradition of education and the worship of God, which I have described. And at that point, many of the leading Catholic independent schools were finding their way back to a classical and confident orthodoxy. The main problem with them, however, was that they were busy pricing themselves out of the market in a race to improve their concrete facilities. Few Catholic families could afford their fees, so they had to take non-Catholics, which then meant that they lost their confidence in religious worship in the heart of their school life. So we had to address that problem by charging a third of what they charge. This has meant that we've had to cut a few corners, and it makes for a humble school, but I think a good one. And one area where we haven't cut corners is on prayer. The celebration of the liturgy has always been at the heart of our daily lives. And it works. A school is at its best, at its most beautiful, is really fully itself in those areas where you can't tell the naughty boys from the good boys. Like many schools, this happens often in sport, in theatre, in music, but it happens most reliably and consistently at the altar. Whatever else sometimes goes wrong around me in this place, the mass is always my anchor, a boy called John once told me. The boy left us over a decade ago and didn't stay in touch. But all this time, he's been on our mailing list And the other day, when we made an appeal for help for our new pupils from the Christian Middle East, John sent a very large donation. When the bishop comes to Chavan, he really knows he's a bishop. Vestments laid out properly, including a dalmatic, boys who know how to genuflect, mitre and crozier bearers with proper vimps, choir in fine voice, organ with all the stops out, Elgar's Ecce Sacerdos, chant that doesn't drag, soaring hymns. Chavagne at its Edwardian Catholic best is a sight and sound to behold. And the boys, even the naughty ones, are proud. We have a boy at the moment who keeps going to the toilet during Mass, another who is a terrible fidget and keeps turning round to look at the people behind him. But strangely enough, they are models of decorum when they're serving. And when a floppy, uncoordinated, unmotivated young man is given an important liturgical job to do, he tends to rise to the occasion. And the experience is a very formative one. He takes pride in his altar serving. One notices that he also begins to take pride in his uniform outside of Mass. And he stands up straighter. The boy becomes a man, a better man, a gentleman. Inevitably, it also has a positive effect on his general behavior and even on the presentation of his schoolwork. AMDG, he writes on every page, and Maiorem Dei Gloria. And serving at the altar gives him a livelier sense of what it means to do something for the glory of God. There is also something physiological going on here. It must be having an effect either at the level of habit, teach boys to do something important well, and it will bear fruit everywhere in their lives, or perhaps at the level of neuroscience. Apart from anything else, for boys who learn to take things seriously, they have to learn to take one thing very seriously indeed, and this is the liturgy. The positive effects are similar to those experienced by commitment to sport. But there is more to it than that, because for the thoroughgoing sportsman, the sacred choreography of serving Mass is a way into thinking aesthetically. It's a participation in something at once beautiful, holy, and important, and to which there is a right answer and a right way of doing things. That's what boys like, even the sportsmen. For a non-sportsman, the liturgy, in teaching a young man somehow about discipline, about balance, about grace, about teamwork, probably ends up making him more reliable on the sports field too, less prone to daydreaming. Meanwhile, in the congregation, daydreaming even has its benefits. Away from the constant stimulation of iPhones and MP3 players, or from teachers who are now no longer allowed to be boring, like they used to be in my day, the fidgety young man can enter into a space of beauty, of stillness, of detachment, of not being entertained. He might get bored. There's no harm in that. A recent study carried out at Harvard University showed how 8-week courses in meditation for teenagers resulted in positive physiological changes to brain structure in relation to attention, impulse control, and anxiety. All classic problems of several teenage boys of my acquaintance. There have been many other similar studies. The celebrated speech and language therapist and medical doctor, Grégoire Thomaitis, who pioneered various treatments in the French-speaking world for dyslexia, famously treated a whole community of monks for depression, anxiety, and general poor health, and eventually discovered that the abandonment of Gregorian chant in the 1970s had made them ill. Singing God's praise is good for you. Education from the dawn of civilization was always about the verticality as much as about horizontality, as much about God as about man. And in almost all cultures, it was carried out by the priests. In our modern day, teachers have rightly been called, by Matthew Arnold, I believe, the priests of culture. Certainly, it's a common phrase when referred to teachers. The other day, I was at the subdiaconal ordination of a young man who came to teach here at the age of 21. A clever man, but still a kid, as most of us are when we're 21, especially these days. After 5 years off, or 5 years here, he went off on the missions and then to seminary. At the ceremony, a couple of weeks ago, were a few of his former pupils who all admired him immensely. One of them is a trainee army officer. He said that he had a general in the army who really inspired him and seemed to have a wonderfully lucid and balanced view of the world and of human nature. He recently asked his general, "Where did you get it all from?" "All you need in this life is a good history teacher," came the reply. "You are that history teacher for me, sir," said the boy to his former history teacher, now destined for the priesthood. It cannot be an accident that our word liturgy originally described a public event that brought together the different clans of one people in ancient Greece, the public thing, especially when they came together for the tragedy, which means the goat song. This was where the poor battered scapegoat was chased out into the wilderness to die for the sins of the people or sacrificed upon an altar. These public gatherings eventually became sublimated. The bloody sacrifices were lived out instead through drama. They used to have a competition for the best tragedy, where horrific tales of death, vengeance, and fate were enacted by old soldiers in masks, the accompaniment of their teenage proteges. The tradition of having competitions for the best tragedy grew out of a kind of a folk tradition of something similar. So there's a kind of a straight line here. So if you go back before people like Sophocles, then you get back to this much more cultic sort of tradition. Anyway, so these tragedies then were enacted by old soldiers in masks, the famous Greek tragedy masks, to the accompaniment of their teenage proteges, the Ephebs, who danced and sang as representatives of the people and of their consciences. Today, the people, rather like the altar boys reciting the confiteor for us, if you like. Today, the people gather to see the old men and the young men enact a tragic sacrifice for the benefit of the whole community. And the young men dance and sing, while the older men perform the main rites. Is this too reductive? Is this too anthropological? I don't think so. I think that all anthropology does is to allow us to see, through studying man's behavior in different times and different places, what is just the basic character of man. And the basic character of man is a religious one. Don't forget, any 5 to 7% of the world disbelieves in God. And in this basic character of man, the vertical relationship with God is what makes the horizontal one with our neighbor not just feasible, but bearable. And the fact that the true religion, with the coming of the Son of God, his death on the cross and subsequent resurrection, which we celebrate this weekend, should somehow answer our basic needs and desires, is arguably just as good evidence that God created us for himself as it could be evidence that we have created God for ourselves. Time and time again, in culture after culture, man has demonstrated that he has a real need to worship God. And civilization flourishes wherever the worship of and wisdom about God is transmitted to the next generation. Even the expression, the priests of culture, is a kind of nonsense in semantic terms. Culture is that which pertains to cultus, surely. And cultus is the worship of God. How could those who tend to the altar of our civilization be anything other than priests, in some sense of that word? It's a bit like calling them priests of worship. Even the very bad cultures of our modern age had their priests and their rites, had their cosmology, their spirituality. I'm thinking of the cult of the goddess of reason. Even the Nazis had their own religious rites. All of these people had, these this cultus, this cosmology, this spirituality was at the heart of their politics and at the heart of their educational endeavors. If we take out the cultus that we know and that has formed our culture and replace it with a chimera of secular piety, which worships other stranger gods, we don't really know where it will take us. Perhaps these new gods are demons, and we wouldn't want to worship them. The life of the tribe, the survival of the tribe, has always been and is always going to be about the celebration of the important thing, the dogma, that on which we have agreed, and which is everything to us. And for our culture, this thing is Christianity. If we wish to dwell in the house of Christendom with all its sweetness, its human rights, its human decency, its search for order, its search for truth, its respect for order, then we must worship its God. And we must teach our children to do so. In the words of Marcello Pera, the Italian philosopher, reputed atheist and friend of Benedict XVI, we should call ourselves Christians. And as education is always the mirror of society or crucible of a future society, then we need to make sure that our children learn how to pray and how to worship their creator, that we give them those wings of prayer, which will make sure that the society we bequeath to them will be one that contains all the best things that have come down to us. I am suggesting here that in the spirit of those English Education Acts since the war, all schools should be praying. All schools should be worshiping Almighty God. I'm not a lawyer. I cannot recommend the best way to achieve that. But I do think that the way it used to be was already better than nothing. And in fact, it was quite good. Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Those were some of the first words that crossed my lips when I was 5 or 6 in primary school. Glad that I live am I, the sky is blue. Glad for the country lanes and the fall of dew. After the rain, the sun, after the sun, the rain, after the sun, the rain, after the rain, the sun. This is the way of life till the work we be done. All that we need to do, be we low or high, is to see that we grow nearer the sky. The whole object of education is to grow closer to the sky, closer to God. I still remember those things 45 years on. And there's absolutely no reason why we can't go back to those good things. It's only, as with many, many good things, it's only inattention that has caused them to be lost. There hasn't been, for example, any legislation against them. They've just somehow ceased to happen. I don't think you'd find parents complaining if children in primary schools learnt to pray the Our Father and things like that again. I'm sure the parents would be delighted. For the moment, while we still have something, some culture to hold on to. Since 2002, when I founded this school, it seemed to me that I might be part of a movement. But unfortunately, that ground has shifted considerably. The sense of the tide being about to turn has sort of abated. And we're now the only ones left standing in the sense of officially Catholic school under the bishop with secondary school with a liturgy at its heart, attempting to perpetuate those traditions of Clement, of Benedict, of Gregory, Augustine, Alfred, and Newman. And we're in France. Although we are in that part of France which belonged for a long time to the English kings, but I keep my eye on what's happening back home. And it seems to me that although the decline in institutions has now reached the point of no return, there is a great deal of hope in individuals. There is definitely a rising generation of young Catholic intellectuals who are drawn to tradition and to learning and to prayer. If they make it into education, then a revival is perhaps not too far off. They're too late to save the existing institutions by rising up through their ranks, but they might start new ones. And they will surely build upon foundations of prayer. The liturgical spirit of conservative intellectual Catholics is one of their principal hallmarks. Whatever they do will no doubt have the liturgy at its heart. I predict that there will be a third spring that might compare favorably to the second spring of which Newman spoke so fervently on the occasion of the consecration of the chapel at Ushaw. about the time of the restoration of the Catholic hierarchy in England. It will be a time when things get better and worse at the same time. There will be the consolation of great saints in the church among all the confusion and all the sadness and strife of the world. Nothing new, perhaps, but that is what happens every time Christian civilization collapses. It is rebuilt again by those who believe. My limited experience of homeschooling with some families in the USA and the UK has introduced me to families who turn their own homes into a kind of domus ecclesiae, with lessons, with liturgical prayer, with devotions, with care of the poor, with the creation of beautiful things. And there are a number of other schools now springing up in the States and elsewhere, where the community of prayer very clearly begets the school, that they, the school, might itself, themselves, beget more communities of prayer. One example would be St. Martin's Academy in Kansas. I haven't visited, but they visited us, wherein between slaying hogs and shooting deer with bows and arrows, the boys attend daily mass every morning. Their school, based on the ideas and inspirations of John Sr., is very much a community of friends who set up their house of prayer and study and then see who wants to come and learn in it. Meanwhile, here at Chavannes, in the strange fruitfulness born of the pain of exile, we in fact have a great time in our little school of the Lord's service, like every good scribe of the kingdom, taking out from our store things that are new and things that are old. When I set up our college, I was very clear in my mind that the main thing I wanted to do was to help people, young people, to serve God better in the middle of the world by being the best at what they do, by being examples for others, drawing others to Christ and to the kind of life he wants us to lead. Over the 19 years of our existence, our pupils have gone on to do this in many different ways. For example, in academia, in business leadership, in the law, in medicine, in the military. And we've seen about one priestly vocation every year drawn from boys or masters at the school. Most of these young men have joined congregations that celebrate the extraordinary form of the Latin Mass, but not all. Interestingly, from September 2002 to June 2020, we had both the ordinary and the extraordinary forms here. But former pupils and teachers who have entered seminary have almost all adopted for the FSSP or the Institute of Christ the King or the Institute Paul Pasteur, organizations like those. Those who have not joined dioceses are open to both forms. Our decision last summer to make the classical form the default position of the college community, we're not any kind of, I don't like the word dogmatic because it's a good word, but it's in a dogmatic way, but to make it our default position is one we have arrived at gradually, but quite naturally over time. For many years, we had the ordinary form and the extraordinary form more or less on alternate days. We got used to chopping and changing, but it was always difficult to explain why we did it to newcomers. Like anyone else, I'm the product of my upbringing, and I'm blessed that it's the things I love which have made me what I am, rather than the things I hated. So it will come as no surprise to readers to learn that my university studies at Edinburgh included a fair amount of Old Norse, Old English, Old and Middle Irish, and some Middle French. I also audited a course in the Latin of the Vulgate. And after a childhood filled with Anglican and Catholic hymnody in a school that formed Isaac Watts, he of Our God I Help in Ages Past, and When I Survey the Wondrous Cross, after service at the altar since the day of my first communion, and years of singing Renaissance polyphony, both sacred and secular, I find myself, rather to my surprise, very comfortable and comforted by a regime of the extraordinary form which, à la française, does not frown on good vernacular hymnody while paying its due reverence to the Liber Usualis. And of course, there are days we psalm turn the offertory or the communion in order to fit in a wonderful hymn or polyphonic motet. It is what people used to do before the council, I suspect, and in many places. I think Augustine of Canterbury or Alcuin of York or Alfred the Great or Clement of Ireland would be quite at home here. Clement of Alexandria might be a little bit dazed after stepping out of his time machine, but he would get his bearings pretty quickly. And even Dr. Arnold, after taking a dismayed look over his shoulder at what has become the Church of England, would probably settle here. We belong to a tradition, and we're both humbled and proud to be part of it. Aside from the package of small details that characterize our look and feel, our way of being school and being church, to borrow a phrase, if you will pardon it, we're not exactly original. We're seeking to perpetuate a tradition that was for centuries widespread and normal, but in this day and age has become something of an exception. Even in the universe of la tradition, which is a real universe here, no other schools, as far as I know, have daily mass for everyone. It has been totally abandoned. Parents might be forgiven for being skeptical about whether that really works. The evidence that it does is only going to be anecdotal, but it is there. We have boys, for example, who become Catholics. And as I've said to you, we've had many boys and teachers who have been open to religious vocations. I hope that a visitor from the past, perhaps the great St. Gregory, looking at our boys, might also say, he came to see us, after seeing their life of prayer and study, which they lead, and with a wry smile, non angli sed angeli, not angles, but angels. I think I better end there because I've gone over my time. Thank you very much. Any questions or comments? You have to put your microphone on, Charles.
Is there anything?
Yeah, I have a couple of questions.
Petra has a few questions.
Go, Petra.
First of all, thank you very much for this lengthy and in detailed elaboration on the history and on the presentation of the connection between worship and education, how it evolved throughout history. I had no idea. I wanted to ask whether I've understood correctly that you decided to found Siobhan School, or what motivated you to found the school was your own upbringing, and you saw the value in it and decided to that it's a good thing, or what elements played into that motivation to found a school like that?
Well, you listened very well to what I said. That's exactly what I said, actually, that I had, like a lot of people who become teachers, I had a lovely time at school. So, I mean, I suppose there are two kinds of teachers, those who hate a school and those who love school, and they go into education for different but the same reasons. So in my experience, I loved my primary school, I loved my senior school, which I described to you at some length. And but I also had a strong sense that when I was at my primary school, in the last couple of years in the primary school, there was a sense in which everything was about to change. Now, I'll explain why. We had a school that went down to about 20 or 30 pupils in the middle of the countryside, and it was ruled with a rod of iron by quite an old teacher, a lady teacher, who had got married in her 50s, and she must have been in her mid-60s on the point of retirement now. And she was very old school, and she would give people a rap on the knuckles, even though that was against the law. And it was very, learning lots of poetry off by heart and lots of hymn singing and so on. And of course, it was Anglican, but it wasn't, it wasn't a church school. It was just a country primary school paid for by the government, you know. And that was the way things were. And then, of course, I remember when she retired and was replaced by a new head. Can you hear me again there?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Can you hear me again?
Yes, we can hear you.
Yeah. So apart from anything else, we had introduction of compulsory sex education, and which was a real shock, you know. And but there were a number of other things. It was like We had a reading, a graded reading system, and I would keep getting to the end of the graded reading system, and I was able to go on to free reading. So I was just reading Dickens and things like that. And but then they would introduce a new system, and I would have be tested, and I'd be put onto the top band of the reading and have to read all these boring books again. Of course, I'd go through the zip through those and get back onto the free reading again. But it seemed to me to be a pointless exercise. So that was about the time when I was about 9 or 10, I started to get into arguments with authority. And and I hadn't done that before because my respect for the authority had been absolute. So and then of course, when I came to senior school, when I was 11 or 12, then sort of went back in the time machine again, because there wasn't, it was quite, I mean, there were some more sort of grown-up things there. I mean, there's perhaps a bit of sex education, but the interesting thing about the school was that it was being run by a headmaster on the brink of retirement again, who was bringing back all the prayers and this sort of thing, and was very careful that all the teachers in the school were very strongly Christian, pretty much. I mean, that's my memory of the place anyway. All the teachers were, you know, they were able to sing harmony and sing hymns properly, and nobody ever criticized the religious ethos of the school, even though it wasn't a terribly religious school, but you know, it was faithful to its identity in that way. And we had very good study of the Bible. The school was very pro-life, very much against abortion. I mean, imagine 1,000 boys in the 90s being taught that abortion was wrong. I mean, it was probably quite rare. But I wasn't aware that it was rare. But by the time I got to 18 or 19, I became aware that this was a world that was slipping away, you see? And so having had a little bit of a brush with death, I mean, a brush with the priesthood, I was thankfully able to avoid by walking out as made a pastoral assistant in a parish, which was a parish from hell. And I walked out of that and ended up going into publishing. I think I've told you this story on a previous occasion. And then, but my first thought, if I wasn't going to be a priest, was really the germ of the idea was, well, everything was sort of okay when I was at school, you know? And the only thing that I would take issue with about the school that I had been in was that it wasn't a Catholic school. So I was, there were quite a few of us Catholics in this non-Catholic school. It's an independent school, a fee-paying school. But when I looked at the Catholic schools around us in Southampton, and I knew people who were in them, their Catholicism was slipping away, you know. So so I think that's the short version of it. You know, I liked school, and I wanted other people to have that positive experience of school. And I also had a feeling of the impending doom of society. I thought, well, you know, the best thing to do is to be a teacher. So, and to found a school. So it took me a while to do it, but I did it when I was in my 30s. And, so that's my story. What's yours?
Well, maybe somebody else has a question, but I just wanted to say also that that when it comes to my own education, I went to different institutions, sometimes when faith was tolerated and sometimes where it was not at all part of the schedule or of people's minds. And I must say that right now I'm at the International Theological Institute in Austria, and it's only now that I actually realize that I'm entering into a process of spiritual maturation, because I didn't really have that before, because education and faith was never really well connected as good as here. So that kind of confirms also what you said, that it has to go hand in hand, and only when it goes hand in hand, it really helps the person to evolve holistically in all aspects of the human person. And it's really fundamental because our first task is not only to learn skills, but to become a human being and a good human person and to know God and worship.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I think your experience of only scratching the surface of what it's all about for a long time until you get to 18, 19, 20, that was my experience, really. Despite having some hints of it, I mean, it wasn't really until I got to university that I sort of... I wasn't a convert, but you know, really understood why someone would convert to Catholicism. I couldn't see that till I was about 20.
I just had the news that my first school, Blessed Sacrament Hollywood, Jesuit school, is closing down this year.
Oh dear.
It was a religious thing. It was a terrible place. My brother put it to me last night. He said, you know, I feel very bad that I don't feel bad. I'm unfortunate. I'm in the same boat. Part of it, of course, is demographic. The neighboring public school is also closing down. You know, in Hollywood, people don't breed. But there's also the fact that we do have a couple of academies in the Los Angeles area along the lines that you indicated, one of which, incidentally, is run by the Carmelites at a regular parish, which are doing quite well. So I suggested to a friend of mine who knows the Archbishop fairly well that if they're smart, really what they would need to do once the current lay administrator's time of the parish is up is to take it from the Jesuits, the parish, I mean, and give it to the FSSP or Christ the King or...
They would probably do something with it, yeah.
Yeah, because otherwise it's just going to keep going downhill. The Jesuit way, as it is developed, both educationally and pastorally, and doctrinally and liturgically, and every other way, doesn't work.
I'm going to have to say thank you to all of you for coming and go back and do my other day job.
A day job?
Yes, as a headmaster. I'm late for dinner, but they've kept some for me, but I need to make an announcement to the boys before they disperse to the four winds. I wish you all a very happy Easter, Mr. Drew, Mr. Darlison, Petra and Charles. I think that's all we've managed to muster today, but I've recorded the talk, so it'll be up there if people want to watch it afterwards.
Excellent.
God bless. Happy Easter.
Happy Easter. God bless. God bless you, Henry and Bye-bye. Drew. Happy Easter.
Bye. Here's the boys are in their civvies. It's the weekend. There they are. They're all.
Oh, there they are.
Okay. All the best. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.